Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Will you all bless?
Amen.
I see everyone's like, is this one? You see, like, your brain will really tick in. If you all have any questions to ask regarding that, any question to ask regarding friends or relationships, so. Okay, I'm going to start something. Like in marriage, sometimes people tend to put their friends before their spouse. Because the friend becomes the third person in the relationship. And when that happens, it's like you find yourself in a place that you are more faithful to the friend than your husband. And then your husband becomes ignored. So if any one of you doing that, you need to watch yourself. Because a good friend will know when to draw the line. As much as my sister is my sister, I will talk and then sometimes I find I'm a bit too long on the phone and I said, you know what, you go and speak to your husband. And I will cut the conversation. And any one of my daughters here who have husband, as soon as I speak to them, I say, is your husband in? They said yes. I say, okay, go and speak to your husband. Because I need each and every one of them to show them priorities. Because when you start that, you bring a discord and it causes destruction in the marriages. So I don't know if anyone have a question regarding that. Or you're still thinking. Because marriage is not only jumping, having a good time in the bedroom. It's deeper than that. It's a lot of things that you all have to bring forward and really be there for each other in good times and in bad times. And then sometimes the bad times might seem even longer than the good times. But because you said that you're going to stand in that situation, then you hold on. I always say, I don't want anyone to use my life as an example to break their relationship. Because I'm not here to tell people to break. I'm here to tell people to make. You know? And my relationship was for 26 years. And I stand, I try, I done everything that I can. So now as it come to this point, it not saying that you all have to come to that point. But you all need to understand, as you hear this word from Pastor Idy today, you all need to understand, is someone taking that place that where your husband or your wife should be? Is someone in that relationship taking, that means that person come the third person in that relationship? And she was saying, who do you listen to? Who do you listen to in that relationship? Because if you find yourself, the person is taking the first place of your spouse, something is wrong. Because you didn't went to that aisle. You didn't go to that altar with that friend. And as you did not go with that friend, you make a promise before God and man that this person is going to be yours forever. So if there's a third person taking that place, something is wrong. And I pray tonight if that happening in any one relationship, they need to look at their life and see where they're going. Because if it's a true friend, they won't stand there. They will be there for building, not to help cut him down. They will be there to cause it to stand. And most of the time in relationship, why it breaks down is because lack of communication. Because we find ourselves not speaking to the man, but the friend is, will get all what you meant to speak to the husband about. And when that happens, you don't know what on earth is going on. But the friend knows. So if that's happening, you need to stop it. It's about building. When you came here today, I said it's about building. And we want to know why. Sometimes we're praying for the demon and it's really our mouth. We speak too much. And I believe, because the Lord's showing me these days so clearly the people. Sometimes I just say things in passing. And as I say it, when I'm praying, I'm seeing the people praying and cutting, you know, so certain things would happen to me. And I was like, wow, so that's it. That's the reason why sometimes when favor is about to happen. And I said, you know, this is about to happen, they cut it. So most of the time, that's what I saw. And I was taking authority earlier on who was here. I saw people meant to marry. And for some reason, in the spirit, it was cut. And you thinking it's your fault. And then you came tonight. So it's time to guard your mouth. Guard your mouth. Because marriage is a spiritual thing. It's very spiritual. Love don't have any color or any words, really, you can really explain it. It's a spirit. So that's why you cannot really help the person you fall in love with. It's a spirit. So I just want you all to ask some questions, or you're just in some deep thinking, or the word just knock you all for six. Praise the Lord. You're going to answer, you know. I could barely see it, but Father, I believe it in eyesight.
Amen.
There's plenty of words there.
Yeah.
Oh, you need glasses like that.
Can I read it out?
Yeah.
It says, what if I am the third person in my relationship? As I'm a person who leaves my substitute. Leaves my substitute.
What is if you're the third person in the marriage?
If it's the marriage, and you are not the person that's married. If the person, if you are married,
I think I'm a husband. I think I'm a husband. Hold on. I think I know. It's a relationship, but the person feel like the third person in the marriage.
Right, okay, so you are the one that's married, mm-hmm. but there's a foreign woman, that's what the Bible calls it, in the relationship. What do you do?
The question is, what if I am the third person in my relationship? Because I am a person who loves my solitude.
Hmm? Solitude? Okay. So you love your solitude, meaning like you like time for yourself or you think a lot? That's one of the tough, isn't it?
In a marriage.
Okay.
I would say that when you are married to a person, okay, let me say from my relationship. I have been married to my husband for quite a while. And he's a very, like what you just said, he's a very, he likes his space and all that. But I am the opposite. And what I do with him is I go and sit with him. He loves football. I will sit with him. I myself cannot stand football, but I sit with him. Why? Because that companion, that relationship is there. Because the reality is, if you exclude yourself too much, he's going to find a toy to play with. That's the reality of life. And if we are in a relationship or marriage, it's give and take. He might not like you always being by yourself or having your own space all the time. And if he sees that you have, men are like babies. Sorry, sir, the men that are in here. They are babies, they are. And at the end of the day, we as mothers know how we pamper our children. And there are many times when you actually want to just shut that door and have a bit of peace. But you don't. You do, but you don't do it as many times as you would like to. That's exactly how our husbands are. You know, if you just try and find something that interests you and him, does that help? Anybody else?
Go ahead. Anybody else?
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When it comes to this word, this marriage problems, is so complex that, just like you said, that men are like babies. They are. You have got to really work hard to keep them. You have to really work hard, and the Holy Spirit helping you to work hard. You have to have a spirit of discernment, discerning him all the time, discerning what he likes and what he doesn't like. When you know what he doesn't like, don't even go there. Don't do it at all. Always try to please him all the time. I know the Bible is there also to guide you, telling you exactly how to manage your husband, manage your home. The Word of God is there to guide you, to help you to do that which is impossible, humanly impossible. That's just the way I can contribute. But the Word of God is there to help you. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. God bless you. Anybody else? I hope that helps. I don't know. It's a process with time. With time. And the work of the Holy Spirit. Okay. Question is, what do you do when you're in a marriage and you feel single? Wow.
That's I think I can understand that point, because I've been there. What do you do? Well, I know what I did. I lean more on God. It's painful. It's really lonely. It's hard. Sometimes you can feel rejected. I went through all the different emotion, and the last thing I did, I said, you know what?
God is just me and you. And when I start seeking God, I start feeling fulfilled. And then it's like I could have carried through. But what do you do? What do you do? I will say, just ask God to help you, to fill you in a way that you don't feel lonely, and for you to be enough for you and for him. I know it's really hard saying that, but sometimes, as Pastor Mary said, it's something you have to work on. I'm telling you, it's hard. You know, especially if the person is not saved. And that was my problem. He wasn't saved. And he had no intention of coming to church. He said so. He said, I don't want a part of it. I just want to be me. You can do you. I can be me. So it was like a separation. He party, drink, smoke, and I'm there. So, you know, everyone there praying and everything for it to happen. But God said no, because he don't want no part of it. And what else could I do? Because I have to carry him, carry the children, carry everything, and still he don't want any part of it. So you just continue seeking God. And God is a God of impossibility. He can do possible things. And you just have to trust in him. You know, but in the meantime, I pray that rejection, you don't feel rejected. Because that is something that causes wrong choices. You know? So I hope it helped. I hope it helped.
Does that answer the question?
If anyone has something to add to that, they can.
I think it's also a case of if in your heart you feel that the marriage is finished, because if you feel the marriage is finished, then what happens is that you even stop trying. Like was said before, it's hard. It's very hard, and it takes the grace of God. It takes the very grace of God. So I think what you have to also do is be honest with yourself, because if you're not honest with yourself, the marriage cannot be restored. If you're honest with yourself, and you feel that it can be restored, then you go on your knees and you ask God to sustain you, and he will. He will fill you, and he will restore the marriage. There's nothing God cannot do. He's able to do all things. But you need to be honest with yourself first. Okay. What do you do when you and your husband are both saved, but he keeps hitting you?
Hey.
Okay.
That's all right, though.
For me, I think that's probably one of the ultimate, the barriers. There's some barriers that men cross, and you stand and intercede. There's some barriers, there's no standing. Because it could cost your life. If he's truly in Christ, You said you're both saved. You can be saved, which is accepting Jesus Christ. If he's truly in Christ, he wouldn't do that. He wouldn't do that. I think you could try Christian counseling. He should try by himself. It's deep because some men is a replica of what they've seen in their life with their parents. So some men want the help. Some don't. So if he wants the help, maybe God will give you the grace. If he doesn't want the help, then you need to run. You need to run with your life. You need to run with your children. Because if you put up with it, your children, whether it's a child, a male child, could become that. Because that's all that child is seeing. If it's a girl, she will receive that and think it's okay. So you need to run for your life and the life of your children.
Because the person needs to want it as bad to be able to get help. And if the person refuses to get help, that means they are comfortable where they are. And you have to make yourself safe because a lot of death happens in relationship through domestic violence. So the person need help.
Can I add another thing, please? If the person does want help, I think it should get help away from the home. Because help is a process. The healing takes time. Domestic violence is real, and it is in the church. May the Lord help us.
Amen.
What if a single woman never been married, but the Lord is telling you that someone in the church is your husband, but you don't know? Okay. But you don't know. He's still married?
Huh?
Is that part of it? Or maybe that's another one?
Is that part of it, whoever it is?
Okay.
It looked like part of it.
Okay, if it's a part of it... Your husband. He's a married man. That might be just your desire. He's a married man. Contradicts everything that the Bible says. Unless you're wishing for the wife to die. That's the only way. I don't think anybody wants to die. Okay. What if God says a man is my husband, but both sides of the family doesn't see eye to eye? How do you deal with that? Wow, okay. It takes the grace to deal with that. If it's God and you're sure that it is God, you have to tie your loin like this. Because it's fire for fire. It's real. It's fire for fire. And whoever stands well is who that will not fall. And if it's God telling you that this is the man for you, You want to make sure that when the missiles are flying, you're not there. As in, it's flying, but it's not touching you. That's why I said you have to tie your loin. That means continuous fasting, praying, fasting. Possibly for a lifetime. Yeah. It's real. It's real.
Something like that happened. Right. Let me see if I can say. I will say somebody, because if I call people, no. Yeah, somebody used to attend my church, and something like that happened. The parents had some way back, they had some issues. And the girl needs to attend, and then the guy start attending. And when I pray, I can see that they're meant to be together, but I don't know what to do. So I continue counseling her and encouraging her. And then the mom and dad became concerned, because the daughter was spending more time with me, and the mom asked to see me, and we spoke, and I said to the mom, Lord, don't put this on YouTube, innit? I said to the mom, would it be nice for you to have the guy close to see what type of person, have your daughter close, therefore trying to accept the guy, and see what type of person, maybe because you don't accept, that's the reason why the child holding on to. And eventually, they allow him to come and meet him and stuff. And today they are happily married, and they're in Nigeria. The family received this stuff. So it can, if God said it, it can happen. It can, but the people have to be willing to change. But she used to be in a lot of prayer and fasting as well. She used to pray and fast a lot. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Having a best friend from a childhood who is married now, as I am married, how do you tell her to give you some space. Oh, okay. If she's a true friend, you shouldn't really have to tell her to give you space. If you're newly married, regardless of your friendship from childhood with her, she needs to understand that that relationship might no longer exist. The relationship is there, but your husband takes priority. And if she's a friend, she should understand. She's a true friend, like I said. Profitable friends want you to excel. They want you to be happy. They want you to be full of joy. Unprofitable friends allow the spirit of jealousy to creep in. And once that spirit goes in, out comes destruction. So you just got to be careful. Ask God to give you the wisdom to step back a bit. How to step back from her a bit. Does that answer the question?
I guess so. Because the one didn't say anything.
My mother's circular advice was to go after my pastor since he's cut my marriage opportunities ever since I was 23. And I am now in my prime, 42. What's your advice? Right, okay. I said this earlier on. I said our pastors are human. They're not God. We shouldn't take everything to them. Now, if this pastor is a man of God, he should have known his limit. If he's cut every person that's come into your life, that's proposed for courtship or whatever the case, then really you should have checked that a while back. This was when you were 23. And now the person's 42. That's a very long time. As a woman in Christ, yes, you take things to your pastor, but you yourself needs to be your own pastor, which is the word of God. You need to get into the word. He will guide you. The words of God will not mislead you. Human beings are pastors. Human beings are pastors. You said your mother's circular advice was to go after your pastor. Is the pastor married? We don't know.
Yes.
Oh, he's married. I think it's very sad. But God is merciful. He's merciful. He's a merciful God. I think as a woman in Christ, I think you need to get on your knees. You probably are. And ask God to direct you. First of all, if I was you, I would leave the church. Because there's a reason why he's destroying or attempting to destroy. He sees your vulnerability. From 23 years old to 42. Come on. That's a very long time. You need to get into a Bible-believing church. Don't allow yourself to be manipulated anymore. You have to stand and move out in the word of God. You have to move out. You running after him, that's not the solution. God is a restorer of hope. Do not lose hope. Even when the situation seems finished, as you're probably feeling, even when all hope seems lost, God is able. He's able, that's his name, he's able to do what your heart desire, which is for you to have a husband that loves you. God is able to do that. Don't lose hope. Find a Bible-believing church. It does not have to be a big church. Ask the Lord to lead you to the right place so that you can be restored. So that you can find someone that will love you for you. not a pastor that's manipulating you for his own interest. We will all answer to the works of our hands, every one of us. If it's good you do, continue. If it's bad, continue. It all has reward. It is well.
What happened along the way while you focusing on the pastor, your pursuer had missed you. You have missed it because you're so focused, and they came. That's why I'm here. They came, and you have missed it. So you will have to do some repenting and ask God to lead you to the person that he has assigned for you. And you, one thing I'm glad that was written, you said your mom, your soul killer. And I prayed that mom. Anyway. You know, sometimes we are mom. I know we did not have a book to say how to be a mom. But sometimes a mom can also be a destiny killer. Because some moms jealous their children. And we have to face fact because they are human. One thing you say about pastoring, I take pastoring very seriously because I don't know if anyone heard my testimony. I died. I saw heaven, and I was sent back to do this work. And each and every one that come into my presence, they can tell you I'm there to lead people to their destiny. I don't know why, I didn't meant to talk about me, but it hurt me to see how some people standing and saying they're men and women of God, and they're manipulating the people of God. It hurts me, because if they know that God is real, heaven is real, hell is real, they wouldn't do such. I take each and every life very important. An incident happened because a part of my school is counseling. And one of my daughters, they tell me something, and I meant to share it with the church because it was for the choir, and I forgot. Because when I sit and we counsel, that's it. I forget everything until we meet again. I train myself to forget it because I don't want to be in that place that they hear it afterwards, because they won't feel good. They would not feel good saying certain things and then they hear it. So it have pastors and pastors. But whoever it is, we're going to pray for that person tonight, because I saw chain breaking. Amen. And that's what we were saying earlier. Chain going to break. Amen. You and marry. The Lord has spoken a word that this conference is going to be marriages, and there will be marriages. Amen. And marriage will be restored. Amen. And it will be restored in the name of Jesus. Amen. I pray tonight that as each and every one of you disclose your information here, it stays here.
Amen. Amen.
Because it's about healing. It's not about knocking and pointing. Because we come to church because it's a hospital. It's a hospital, and that's what we're here for, to get healed. So I don't want anyone pointing fingers of certain things that is said in here tonight.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen.
After these, if anybody have anything, just bring it quickly, otherwise I won't be taking any more questions.
Should religion come between?
You want to say something regarding that?
Yeah. It was just the phrase, go after him, that I wanted to address.
Yeah.
You know, the Bible says, he who finds a wife finds a good thing. It doesn't say the woman who goes after a man finds a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
The the role and function of a single woman, if you look at the great women of the Bible, Rebecca, for example, when Isaac sent his servant to find a wife for, when Abraham sent his servant to find a wife for Isaac, he found Rebecca working, going about her daily business, minding her business, being a woman of virtue. Even Abigail and David, Abigail went out operating in wisdom to stop a tragedy. And it's only after her husband died that David then went and brought her to be his wife.
Yes.
So I think for women, I'm a single woman myself, but it's about developing yourself, immersing yourself in the Word of God, living for Him, doing the, letting Him lead you and guide you, and then allowing the Holy Spirit to lead the man to you, to find you and discover you in the appointed time. And the other point I wanted to make as well about moms was that you were talking a lot about friendships and keeping our mouths shut. But I think for me, what happened in my own life was that my mother made me her confidant regarding her marriage, which was a very hard one. And so we might be going to friends to talk about the husband, but I want to speak to the moms here as well. Don't use your children as your confidants regarding your marriage.
It's true. It's very true. Very true. Praise God.
When you talk about repentance, how do I go about repenting about it?
Look, you just ask God to forgive you, because really you've done it out of ignorance, because you know a mother figure in your life tell you so, you obey. So you just ask God to forgive you for that, and then after you forgive.
For having those thoughts, entertaining those thoughts in any capacity.
Yeah, and then who God have sent for you, you're going to ask God to let them locate you. Mm-hmm. So we're going to pray that prayer for the person for you.
Can I also add something to
the limit, keep the person for me? When the Lord sends the person, you should keep the person for me.
No, because you right now you are so zoned into that person, but it's the wrong person. So we're going to pray for that to break and for you to see the one that God has sent you. That's what's going to happen. Because you need to live and enjoy life.
Can I also add to you? I think also that you need to get into the Word for encouragement. You know, when you have been under the spirit of manipulation, it sucks you. And it takes so much from yourself. So what I'm saying is that you need to allow, get into the Word, so the Word of God can build you, so that you'll be bold instead of timid and fearful. Do you understand? That's what I see with you. That spirit of fear and desperation. Get into the Word of God so He can build you. He can solidify you. He can make you into the woman you're supposed to be, that you were. Does it make sense? Get into the Word. The Word is closer than the brother. The Word of God does not change. Human beings change. His Word is constant. His Word brings joy, brings peace, takes away the fear, takes away the desperation, takes away the hopelessness. Because how you're feeling is hopelessness. There's a void there. It's only God that can fill it. Ask God to bring the right people into your life to help you grow spiritually. Do you understand? It is well. It says, should religion come between two people that are willing to get married irrespective of their religious differences. She is Christian, he's a Muslim. Okay, I will answer that, and then, then we can add to it. The Bible says it, so do not be unequally yoked. It's a different situation if you are both non-believers and you married, and then one finds Christ, the other one finds Islam. It's different. But this one, there's no union. Why do you want to go into a relationship that's going to bring destruction? It's like seeing fire running inside of it. It's not possible. It's not logical. In marriage, there's some years that you will even ask, was I blind when I married him? Am I lying? You're going to say, maybe he hypnotized me. Yes. Marriage is not nobles. It's not meals and bones. It's real. With real situation and real people. It's real. You do not want to run into open fire, which is what's going to happen if this takes place. Love only expands if there is unity and understanding. Understanding is the foundation for what? For unity. If there is no understanding, that relationship is going to split. It's not going to stand the test of time. We see our mothers. They endure. Marriage is not supposed to be endured. You're supposed to be in one accord so you can enjoy your life. Not endure the marriage or the man. There are times when that love is going to fade. And it's going to take the relationship, the understanding in Christ, if you're one in Christ. If you are Christian and he's Muslim, where is the foundation? The love will not last. Trust me. It's not going to last. You're running into fire and chaos. And then
it's like holding a hand grenade.
It's just a matter of time before it explodes.
It won't explode. You hope it won't explode.
But it's just a matter of time before it explodes. And look at the children that you bring into it as well. That will be another broken home. You will be running into... Nobody goes into marriage planning for the marriage to break. But with this, it's almost guaranteed. If your husband is a Christian and he fell in love with another woman,
gosh. Hey.
Your husband is a Christian. Tell him to fall back out of love. You just don't fall in love with someone. You have to spend time with that person. Love doesn't slap you in the face. That's only in books and films.
Yes.
What do you mean he fell? Tell him to fall back out.
Fair.
Fell.
to stand up.
Yeah, stand up.
Tell him to stand out of, yes, stand out of the love.
Oh, hallelujah. But
it's sad because it happens. If you still love the man and you want to save your marriage, then I suppose the grace is there. But he needs to want it. He doesn't. If he's fallen out of love, or rather falling in love with another woman, he's not even seeing you. Because we know, we all know how men are when they claim to be in love. They don't see nothing else but themselves. They only see their needs. They don't even necessarily see the woman they're in love with. It's just the need they have of that woman. So, if you are married to a man that's fallen in love with another woman, he's going to take the grace. I know under grace, God can do all things. But the patience, ask God if you really still want this man and the marriage should work. Because you might have kids and whatever else, ask God to give you the grace. And ask God to help him fall out of the love. And the woman can disappear. God should ship her to another country or something. Give her another job somewhere else. I don't know.
It's
the grace.
The husbands meant to think the wife is the one and only person, the best person in the world for that person. So sometimes when things like that happen, is either communication breakdowns start happening, or you don't see eye to eye for something. Because most of the time, you will be in a relationship and everything going fine, but then all of a sudden, maybe say like around the football, and you want that time with him, and then he wants to look at football, and then you say, oh, I sure wish he could spend some time with me, I sure wish this could happen, and then you walk down the street and a guy telling you the same thing, and it could happen with a woman as well, the same thing that you want to hear the person that you would say, someone else that just saying it, and you're thinking, wow, this person knows exactly what I want or what I like, and that's how things happen, you know. So, if that person could, instead of that happening from that point, just go back and say, you know what, something is happening because I wanted you to do certain things, and you know, and people outside are offering me stuff like that. Let them know that they can lose you. So it could, you know. So it has to be from the beginning for it to be broken. But when you keep quiet on it and you keep entertaining it, eventually something will happen. You will do fall. And they say, it just happened. I don't understand that. It just happened. So, you know, you close, just strip everything out, and it just happened. How could it happen? It takes time before it happened. It just happened.
This prayer and fasting.
Yes.
Yeah, you have to. Because sometimes, as Christian, it has seducing spirit out there that lure your husband. And that's the reason why you need to be in prayer together. You know, I have learned a lot from what happened to me, because we never used to pray as we should, because most of the time we leave very early in the morning, the job he used to do, and then when he come, he's tired and stuff like that. I used to pray for him, but praying together is important.
Can I add another thing? Sometimes, this is not an excuse, but we as mothers, we're so caught up with our kids, we leave the husband, literally leave him outside, as in out there in the cold, and we're here playing a role with the husband outside. Is that possible? But we do it every time. We women do it all the time. We get so caught up raising our children, you know, even in that you lose yourself, you know? maybe your husband is used to you putting on nice makeup, you look clean when he comes home, and you look like, he comes home, you look like World War III. It's real. This is a woman's conference. This is what's happening. Women attracted to what they see. They're attracted to what they see. Whether we like it or not, that's the reality. Whether he's a Christian or not a Christian, he's got blood running through his veins.
No, honestly.
Yes.
For those who are married, they need to date each other. So like have a date night.
Don't get so caught up with your children that you leave the man outside. He says, you know, sweetheart, and you're like, I'm tired. I've been working the whole day. Hello? Mm-hmm. You know, move, sweetheart, you know. Move to the other side. Move. We do it. We women do it. I'm tired. You went to work, I went to work. I came home, cook, clean, children. My husband would say, leave the cleaning.
That's a good
one. Just leave it. Yes. You said, I didn't send you to clean. Clean me. Yes. I'm serious. We need to leave the choices. Even with God, even in the kingdom of God, everything is a process. Let's leave things. Certain things, you will leave it. But to be with your husband.
Even though you're doing the chores, you wear something sexy and you look fat.
Thank you. There you go. Now we're talking.
I bet you don't have to move anymore. You just wear that thing and you work.
He'll be like, leave the Uber. Leave it on. Don't even turn it off. Just leave it as it is. I remember when I first had my kids, my husband used to say, oh, you know, Idy, this kids are taking so much time. I mean, but the kids need me. He turned around and said, I need you. It's real. We need to also check ourselves and let's go back to dating. That husband that's falling for another woman, make him fall back to you. You know, try and look, maybe do the things you used to do when you were 14. He's not blind. He can see. He will see that you're trying. Let's get real. Last one. What if you're married and one is Pentecostal and he's attended another religion? What should one do? Okay, so he's not a Christian. Mm-hmm. Okay.
But they're already married.
But you are married to him. Again comes the grace. The grace of God. A lot of patience. A lot of interceding. You have to intercede for your husband. Even more so because you're not on the same level. Spiritually, you're not on the same level. So you, women are the builders. See how you nurture your children. And you teach them. And you nurture them. And you build them. That's what you have to do with this husband. Don't batter it like this. Don't do that. Leave the battering to God. You just do. With a heart of...
And start speaking nice words to each other.
You know, with a heart of patience and more patience and more patience and a lot of prayers. And just being nice. Just being nice. Sometimes we're so caught up with this Christian thing, we're horrible. Even the devil sees us and runs and says, they are supposed to be Christian. to be like that. And even more so with a husband. Okay, I'm not born again. You're not born again. Therefore, you close your legs. Why? Why? Is that what the Bible tells you to do? No. That's his duty. It's like, for men, it's like breathing. You suffocate him. You take the air. He's no more. Don't take his needs, his desire from him. With patience and prayers and interceding, God will touch his heart in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
A lot of hurtful words sometimes being said that cause pain in marriages. So start learning to speak life back into each other. And date again. Learn to date each other. Learn to date, because when you all started it, you all were dating. You all were, you know, doing things that please each other, for each other, making each other happy, you know? And try doing that again. Try to bring the spice back into it. And just enjoy life. Because both of you all came from two different places. And these two different have to come together and make one. So it will have a little friction before you get it right. But eventually, with a lot of prayer, it will happen. But don't get despondent. Don't give up. And just enjoy. In everywhere that you are, enjoy. Even in the pain, enjoy. I know it's not what you want to hear, but just learn, because everything that happens in life, whether good or bad, is a lesson to be learned for a purpose. And eventually you will understand why. But just don't look at the negative things. Just understand. Because, you know, most of the time we go through certain things for others. Like, when this had happened to me, a lot of people expect for me to cry and be frustrated and stuff. But God took that away from me. And when God said to me, I have to do this program, and I'm thinking, I was laughing, I was saying, you have a sense of humor. But I realized my pain, it was to help others, not to go there. And the one who said the feeling lonely in the marriage, I really feel it, because if you do not pray and really ask God to intervene in that marriage, He can eventually bring to the point where I am. Because at one point I was like tired praying. I was like, God, how long could I be praying? And He keeps saying, no, no, no. And after, I'm being honest, after I remember the Lord said to me, pray. I said, I'm not praying anymore. Because I went to, I used to go to the retreat every year, and I would just be on the floor, just crying out for Him, crying out, year after year. And He will change a bit, but every time He goes away and He comes back, it changes. If He stay, I know it would have happened, but every time He travels. And then I realized, he had someone there. That's why he travels so regular. But if that didn't hurt me, it's like I had already known, because a year before I found out, the Holy Spirit keeps saying, he got someone else, he got someone else. Mm-hmm. So when I traveled to their wedding, I had known. But I still go through, you know, because I said, I don't want to be the one that caused the division. I said, Lord, I solely put myself in your hand, and I don't want to be the one. I will try as much as I can. Even though you know you're feeling lonely and stuff like that, I will try. And then one day I was praying, the Lord said, it's finished. So He released me. So I don't want anyone go and make hard decisions. That's it. You know, sometimes
It takes two. So you have to find out where you're going. And men and women in here, don't be afraid to go and receive counseling, because counseling is not to make you feel bad. Counseling is showing you where the lack is. That's all it is about, where the lack is and where you can amend stuff. So now, you know, men have a tendency to be, because I used to say, let's go for counseling, let's go. And you said, no.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a man thing, no. Yeah. But it's just to find out where you are.
Yeah.
And you will receive help and it will show you, you know, or direct you, this path I'm taking is not the path that I should. That's all it is. And when you refuse that, you refuse to grow. And you stay in that same place thinking it's right, and it's no progress, as you will say. There's no progress. And it just causes more and more pain. So just come out from that and just stand. Make a stand and say, you know what, the marriage worth keeping. I'm going to stand and I'm going to make this thing work no matter what. And it will work. It will work. Because that's what it is for. That's what God wants. God very concerned about marriages. He's very, very concerned. And what's happening now in the world, it's paining him. That's why he asked me to do this. It's paining. But the ones who are getting ready to do it, he wants you all to take the right step, make the right choice. And let him be part of it. Don't just do it because of loss. Do it because of love. And you will see it work. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Just give us a hand. You all have been such wonderful people. I just thank God for each and every one of you. And as we said, we're going to pray for this lady. Could you come?